the first four verses and kind of share with you a little bit of way back when Prophet Isaiah was prophesying what was going on in John 3:16. Okay? About God's reach for sinners. God's reach. Let me tell you something right now. God has been reaching, trying to touch hearts throughout the centuries. Problem is, mankind has been shunning, rejecting, walking away, ignoring God's compellingness, begging and pleading and loving kindness, has been trying to draw people to Him. And so many times I want to help you here, help you understand three things when it comes to God, how God's position on all that is, what our position needs to be, and then what happens when we receive Christ, what we should be doing, okay? So here in Isaiah chapter 59, starting in verse 1 through 4, says this, "Behold, the Lord's hand is not shortened that it cannot save, neither his ear heavy that he cannot hear. But your iniquities have separated between you and your God, and your sins have hid his face from you that it will not hear. For your hands are defiled with blood, and your fingers with iniquity. Your lips have spoken lies. Your tongue has muttered perverseness. None calleth for justice, nor any pleadeth for truth. Thy trust is vanity, and speak lies. They conceive mischief, and bring forth iniquity." It's a lot of stuff there, amen? But being saved 30 years and seeing all kinds of stuff in the ministry and all kinds of stuff in this life period, even as a Christian, that brings to me a great clarity of how deceiving the heart can be, how blinded a mind can be, and how much of a life of a living lies that the people that live lies in life can be because of how what the sin has done to a person's life. Amen? And can I tell you this morning, I just want you to know that God has been constant through the whole thing. Amen? God has always been there. God has never abandoned. God has always reached and begged, has pleaded for people to come to Him and the whole entire world to come to Him. But the sin has separated His reach. Sin has separated His loving kindness. Sin has separated His pleading and begging to come to Him. The ears have gone deaf, and the eyes have been blinded, and the mind has been refuting and denying Christ for centuries. But God has still been trying to reach. Why? Because He's willing that none should perish, right? And that all come to repentance. Can I tell you, this morning, Christians have been abandoning God for the sake of saying, it's too late now, the world's going to end, the place is too wicked, why even bother? Right? If we've been complacent in the church house, Christians have been like, oh, someone else will lead someone else to Christ. Someone else will give the gospel out. But God's been trying to reach, and we need to be what we need to be for God, for that message of hope, that blessed hope of who He is to save the whole world. Amen? Let's pray. Father, again, thank You so much for this time. Lord, I pray that You would help us understand who You are in this whole mix of things when it comes to You trying to reach people, You trying to reach the individual. Lord, in 2017 at Charity Baptist Church, we're trying to start focus on this lost soul of an individual. Lord, if You want to bring more than just one, so be it. But we need to be concentrating on our personal responsibility, who You are in reaching the lost for Your glory. Lord, I pray You bless this message. Holy Spirit, touch the hearts. Provoke the minds, encourage and edify, lift us up to do a great work for You. In Jesus' name, amen. I want you to understand God's position in this whole thing. Remember now in John 3:16, He says, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son." He gave up His Son unconditionally out of love, right? Sacrificially, the Lord came and died on a cross so people can come to believe on Him. So that they would not, look at, that they should not perish, but have everlasting life. That's what He gave. He gave up something. Now, here in life, people give up a lot. They said, not because of sin, they give up. I'm talking people give up stuff out of giving and a loving heart. It's called sacrifice. It's called all conditional, unconditional love. Last week, we talked about the chief shepherd. Today, we're talking with the shepherd. You know, shepherds do. But today, we're talking about how God is, when He looks at a whole entire world of people that are denying Him and rejecting Him. How do you know that? How do you know that? Because, yeah, sin has run rampant, and the church houses are not full any longer. You go to a lot of churches, they're not full any. Sunday's no longer church. Sunday is fishing, hunting, family entertainment, and stuff like that. It's not, sometimes other things. God is nowhere in the mix as a priority longer in society today. When Sunday was a day put aside to worship God, then you hear the excuse, well, we should worship God every day. Well, yeah, you should. But it's an opportunity to come to church on Sunday to worship it together and to edify and encourage each other and to hear great testimonies like we heard today. Now, imagine all the people that are not here today. They missed out the blessing to hear what God's done. God raising $2,000 in a matter like this to buy a new transmission for the van for our ministry because church is not important. Now, I'm not talking like Christians Lake can't. We could probably bring a bed and put her in a cot and bring her here, but you know what I'm talking about. People are like, well, it's Sunday, I'm not going to church. Other people think there's so many priorities besides giving God this time. Yeah, you should every morning give God your time, right? Start the day off. But when it comes to a church, it's something special being together with other believers, right? And hear us all sing unto the Lord and edify. So church, so God has been dealing with the gainsaying people. Have you heard these Hollywood stars on Facebook, how they mock God? These politicians have no regard for God any longer? How certain bureaucracies will not sit there and put "In God We Trust" on police cars and other things? Don't we want God to protect our police officers in the field? But we're forbidden to do that. How about schools? They won't let the Christian pray, but they'll let the Muslim pray. How's that fairness? How's that equality? How's that justice? How's that really freedom of religion? How is good for one group and not the other group? Right? Let's go a little bit further. National anthem at sports things, right? They don't want to do it no longer. Why don't they want to do it? Because it says, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice. God is constantly on the attack from every angle in our school systems, at sporting events, in different entities that protect and serve us, like the police officers, EMTs, and firefighters. You cannot sit there and mention the word God. But every other thing else you can sit there and you can mention because it's supposedly it's not offensive. How did God become so offensive to you? World? When all God has done is blessed and showed his loving kindness and sent his only begotten son. God's reach for sinners has been going on for decades and centuries to reach down to a people that constantly reject God for who he is and what he is. I don't know about you, but have God's been, whatever thing that God's been put through and rejected and denied and mocked, we're still here. Why didn't God just sit there and say, I'm done with all you? All gone. He could do that, right? But doesn't that show his mercy? Does that not show his loving kindness? Does that not show his grace? That shows all that, don't it? Because he could. He could just sit there and say, and it's like he put the whole universe in words. He just said, earth exists, right? Give me some light. He could sit there and say, universe end, and we're all done. We're all gone, right? He could. There's a few words. Think about that. He gave himself on the cross for you and I. That's how God's position is in this whole thing. Romans chapter 5, verse 8 says, But God commendeth his love towards us. You can turn to Romans chapter 5, verse 8. But God commendeth his love towards us, and while yet we're sinners, Christ died for us, even in the act of doing. That's when the people say, I'm too far gone. No, you're not too far gone. Is your heart still beating? Are your eyes still open? Are you still walking on your own 2 feet? Yes, you are. Then you're not too far gone. God still has an opportunity to want to work on you. Hallelujah. All you got to do is let that understand how much he truly does love you. And understand his act of love unconditionally and sacrificially did on that cross. Right? Think about that. Turn over to Ephesians chapter 3 if you could. Ephesians chapter 3. We'll turn over there real quick. So don't tell me that God is a mean God or an unjust God. No. I'm going to get into a little bit here about man's position on how God reaches. I want to show you God's side of the story a little bit. God is not unjust. God is not unfair. God is loving and he's kind. People just misunderstand him and who he is. I heard a lot of times people say, how can a God that loves so much allow so many people to die? I said, he don't allow people to die. People put themselves to let them die. Their choices put them in situations where they choose death over life. All those bad things happen because other cultures have adopted a way of living and has spilled and have dumped on the people around, the innocent people, because of their choices. Do you know there's countries and nations in this world, because it's underneath government control, the people got to live in poverty, unsanitary places, right? And the people that are in government, that get all the money, are living on high off the hog, right? And then they do these great concerts in the past. What's that one they did way back in the day, in the 80s? What was that? We Are the World. Yeah, that. Thank you. Boy, that's going way back. Some of us old people, we know what that is, right? Some of the young ones are like, what the heck is he talking about? Okay, We Are the World. You know all that money that was raised up never got there? The government did. You can do all the rock star stuff, all the music, and I'll gain all the money, whatever. Then they can do nothing. Because the government's going to snatch it. I know missionaries are on foreign fields. I know missionaries that are on foreign fields that they have to smuggle in medical equipment and medical stuff just to treat the people they're trying to minister with the gospel with. Because if the government gets sniff of it, they're going to take it and put it in their hospital. Think about that. That's the kind of cruel world we're dealing with. But God has always been merciful, trying to help and do what he can. Here in Ephesians chapter 3, if you could. Ephesians chapter 3. Look what God's position is. His hands have been stretched out. His hands have been trying to reach the lost and sinners for so long. And he's looking. He wants to love them. And in Ephesians chapter 3 and in verse 17, the Bible says this. That Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith. That ye, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and the length and the depth and height, and to know that the love of Christ was past knowledge, that you might be filled with all the fullness of God. Now to him that is able to do exceeding and abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that worketh where? In us. When a person gets saved and born again and accepts Christ, you have a power inside of you that is able to get you to where you need to be to get close to God. And all that sin and all that failure and all that pain and all that uncertainty and all that doubt and all that thing that you try to control, you don't need to control no more. And God can take on over. God wants you. God's been wanting the soul of man for the longest time. He's given every opportunity to reach down for sinners. He sent his son to die. He wants to be believed and trusted and have faith in, to be born again, to trust in him to be born again. And then he wants to do great and mighty things in your life. And it all starts in the inside and the heart. You've got to let him have you. You've got to let him love you. You've got to allow him to have control and watch what God does. He says right there, look at now, he says this. Ready? He says, now unto him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us. He's that power, amen? Look, our willpower will weaken, right? I'll tell you, there's days where I just want to go home and collapse. But then God gives you a little ounce of whatever to go on further on, right? Let me ask you a question. When the weights of life come on your shoulder and you're struggling and you're trying to get whatever, can I tell you, people sit there and say, how are you making it, right? This is that lifestyle evangelism stuff we talked about earlier. You can sit there and say, how can you put a smile on? How can you be joking? I go, because I know God's in control. I have to sit there and put my faith and trust in him. It's out of my control. It's all God now. So I'm going to follow him. Because he already knows the landmines ahead. He already knows the trouble that I might be encountering. But he also knows where the blessing's coming. And I want to be there when that blessing comes. I want to find where I want to get there. I want to get to that point where things are looking good and I'm in a safe place and God's giving me great peace and blessing. I'm in a place where God can work on me greater because I want to, and what is all you're doing is you want God to love on you more. Amen. I want to get to the place that God's loving on me more. That's what I want. Hallelujah, right? That's God. God wants that for you and I. When God reached down to sinners, that's his intention. Turn to 1 John chapter 4, if you could. 1 John chapter 4. 1 John chapter 4. Just to let you know, we're doing good on time. We're not missing NASCAR. There's no Bills game. They've been done, okay? Hockey ain't on until 6 o'clock tonight. They lost anyhow last night, so they stink too, all right? We're doing all good, all right? 1 John chapter 4. Look what the Apostle John says. Now, this is now the Apostle that at the time of when Jesus was going to give himself up to be sacrificed, and he was being taught and discipled and taught and everything else by Jesus, the Apostle John put his head upon the bosom of Jesus' heart, and Jesus calls the one whom I loved. Okay? The beloved one. So 1 John 4, look at verse 19 if you could, okay? 1 John chapter 4, verse 19 says this. We love him. Why? Because he first loved us. Think about that. How many are convinced this morning that God loves you? Are you sure? Let's reciprocate that love by giving yourself to him every day. And allow him to do what he needs to do in your life. And your journey through life as you walk with him as a child of God, as a Christian, if you're saved and born again, you accepted the Lord Jesus Christ in your heart, you might say you understand his love, but now you need to experience his love. And the only way you're going to do it is you allow him to take over and show you great and mighty things when you pray and you ask and you give yourself over to him. Amen? And then you're going to really experience his love. God's intention reaching down to sinners that are lost, when they get saved and born again, God has so many things to show the lost soul on this earth if they're just willing to start with one thing, and that is accepting and getting saved and born again, right? That's the whole purpose why he died for the whole world. That's the whole purpose why he wants to even begging and pleading and reaching out to sinners, right? So they can get saved and born. If you're here this morning and you're not saved and born again, and you don't know for sure if you die, where would you go? I want to help you. I'd love to have someone show you how you can be saved and born again so you can get that thing started. Amen? But let's look at man's position now. How many agree that God's position is true, right? Do anybody doubt that? I mean, people should not be doubting God, that God doesn't love me. My life's cursed. I've heard Christians say that all along. Throughout all the years and centuries, my gosh, I keep hearing Christians tell me that God doesn't love me. God's. I don't know why God's punishing me in my life. Because maybe your faith is not where it needs to be. Christians should not be talking like that. Can I tell you this morning, God's position is true, and it's right, and it's just. But man's position has been a battle since the get-go. Amen? Man needs to realize God's position so that man then can realize their position. We need to realize that we're the ones that need him, right? Right? God don't need us. We need him. And in that, knowing that, God, we need to understand that mankind throughout the century does not want to seek God. Why do you think mankind, people do not want to seek God? Who could tell me? Well, we know it's sin, but that's a general term. Give me some deeper stuff. What's that? Oh. They don't want to seek God for guilt. Well, guilt from where? The guilt of their sin. The guilt of what? Go ahead. They don't think they need him. Yes. Why is it that mankind thinks they're going to survive without God? Well, first of all, people think, I'm good enough. I'm okay. I don't need no God. I'm a man's man. They trust in their own self. Let me ask you a question. When you get beat down and you can't handle the pressures of life and you're tired, you're worn out, and then you seclude yourself and you're hurting people around you with all that kind of stuff and you're whatever, man sooner or later realize they're going to need, the whole issue is they're going to have to find their point. Like I said in Sunday school, 10 o'clock hour, talk about witnessing. They're going to have to come to the point where they're going to see the need for Jesus. Okay? And hopefully we're there knocking on their door, right? We're there ready to pass a track over. We're there right next to me, maybe at the workplace or in the home or whatever neighborhood, that they come knocking on your door and say, I'm hurting. Well, while I'm here, what's up? You know, want me to pray for something? Then you get an opportunity to tell somebody about Jesus. Think about that, right? Man's position has been not seeking God because of the guilt of the condition. Remember Adam and Eve? When they sinned against God in the garden, they ran and hid. They had no need for God because God was going to deal with that thing, right? How about Jonah, the rebel pastor, I call him, right? The rebel pastor. Is that you, Pastor Pete? No, it's not me. Right? God told him to do something. He goes, I ain't doing it. And he did it anyhow. He swam him up, gave him a bald head like me, right? Or actually, like Rob. Rob has more less hair now. He was shaved it last night. Bald head like that, you know? And he came out, he had no eyebrows either, too, you know? Came out there and preached, and he goes, brought to Nineveh, all miserable. He had to yield a little bit to it, right? And then preached to Nineveh, and all of a sudden, people got saved left and right. He had a big, great revival, all from a rebellious preacher named Jonah, right? So man has constantly been refuting God. Man has been, even Christians, they have Christ living inside, have been refuting God's will. And remember I said at the beginning, God is willing that none should perish but all come to repentance, right? So God's willing for that. Turn over to Romans chapter 3 if you could. Romans chapter 3. We'll look at a couple of verses here and then we'll get to my last point. Romans chapter 3. Romans chapter 3. Look what Paul says here. Paul's been dealing with a group of people here in Rome. In Romans chapter 3, I want you to look at verse 11. Actually, we'll start in verse 10. Romans chapter 3, starting in verse 10, says this, as it is written, there is none righteous, no, not one. That's including you, Christian. Don't think higher yourself than what you are, right? There's none that understand, there is none that seeketh after God. Now, here's the key to this whole thing. Look at that verse in verse 11. There is none that understand. The reason why they're not seeking for God, because they don't understand. Sometimes you've got to be put in a position in your life to sit there and say, I need to seek after something, and hopefully it will be after God, right? Because once you find God, remember when you got saved and born again, how much understanding you got? How much you found you never knew that a God loved you enough that he sent his only begotten Son, that God does love me. And when you received the Lord Jesus Christ, the great peace you've had, and the great joy you had, and you saw all this beautiful, you said, I didn't know God had all this for me. I didn't know God was even there. I did. I know some of you did, because I remember when you got saved. I remember how you shared some of your testimonies, and now you start getting some understanding. But we need to continue following through and get greater understanding. Turn to Romans chapter 1, if you're good. Romans chapter 1. This is the society in a nutshell right here. Romans chapter 1. I'm just going to go ahead and, I want to jump around. I want to share the whole thing. Let me see a little bit. Okay, ready? Starting in verse 22, we're going to read right down to the end there. So follow me real quick. Romans chapter 1, starting in verse 22, says that professing themselves to be wise, they became fools. You ever talk to a person that believes in evolution? We were talking about somebody that wants to sit there and I like this. Back in the day, we used to pass out tracts on the street and they used to sit there and talk to these big, you know, like we call them the street punks, you know. I'm going to party in hell! They pound their chest. I go, you are! I go, man! They start lighting up their cigarette, you know. I go, take your lighter out. I said, you're tough, aren't you? I'm tough, man. So I'll lock you out right now. I go, well, you can try. But anyways, they did the lighter, right? And I told them, put your hand over that lighter. So as you're going, let me talk to you while you're doing that. It didn't last no longer than 30 seconds. Ow! I go, put your hand back over there. I go, if you can't handle that for 30 seconds, how are you going to do that for eternity with all that flames all over you? If you can't hand over a lighter for 30 seconds, how are you going to do that when your whole body's consumed with flames? You ain't tough. You're a punk. And let me tell you about Jesus. That's how he did it. You're in denial. You're in denial. You don't understand. See, we want to sit there and preach and condemn, but I'm going to tell you what we need to do is we need to help them understand. Understand God's position. Understand where they're at in their life, in their position, and show them and point them to Jesus, the one that loves them, the one that is one that they don't perish and die and go to hell. You and I are the ones that can do that. We're no good sitting in a seat at the church doing nothing. We're no good sitting on our couch and our chair in the living room doing nothing. We're no good with keeping our mouth shut, not saying a word. We're no good for the cause of the gospel by not sharing the gospel and trying to witness when someone's lost in their understanding. Amen? You see how 10 o'clock kind of matches up 11? Listen, this is already picked out like 2-3 days ago, so I'm sorry. Let's go down a bit further. You ready? It says, where was I? Romans. Now we're in chapter 1. Chapter 1. Ready? Professed himself to be wise and became fool. Verse 22. 23 says, and changed the glory of the uncorruptible God into an image made like the corruptible man, into birds, into four-footed beasts, and creepy things. Wherefore God also gave them up to uncleanness through the lust of their own what? Their own hearts. So when your heart says, oh, but it feels good. It has, oh, but I feel so good. It has to be right. No. Okay, it does not feel good. Sometimes painful things are good. It got quiet. Let me say it again. Sometimes painful things are good. You know why sometimes pain's good? Because you'll learn from being deceived with that pain. Let me talk about, listen, please don't ever say this to your wife or another woman because you might get beat up. My wife's looking like, hey, what are you going to say? She says that to me all the time. You're going to say something stupid. I know you are. Ready? Okay? You men, because I did this and I got beat up, okay? Now we get it. Okay. when we pass a kidney stone, don't ever tell your wife that it's like giving birth to a child. You will get beat up. Okay? Right? You will get beat up. Don't ever say that to your wife because you're in the doghouse. It's like giving birth to a child. No, it ain't. Giving birth to a child is pretty painful. But is there a joy at the end of all that? Yes or no? Look up here. Is there a joy at the end of that? We've been able to hold that baby, love that baby up, right? Yes? Sometimes pain, look at it. It took pain and agony and sacrifice for some people in this country to go to war for our freedom, right? So we can enjoy freedom. Can I tell you, this morning, sometimes people need to understand that our hearts lead us in a wrong direction. But sometimes God could take our choices of pain and bring great joy from that pain. Amen? So it says here, the lust of their own hearts, to dishonor their own bodies between themselves, who changed the truth of God into a lie. Well, we're seeing that a lot, right? Like, we had a Baptist preacher tell me that, I can't say it. Never mind, I'll go back. There's some even Baptist preachers say some stupid things. They have. I won't get into it for the sake of some of the young ones here. But they get some stupid stuff that comes out of their mouth. And I'm sitting here, what? So people can take the scripture out of context and make it into their own thing. So it says, and change the truth into a lie and worship and serve the creature more than the creator, who is blessed forever and ever. Amen. For the cause God gave them up unto vile affections. For even their women did change the natural use into the which is against nature. And likewise also men leaving the natural use of the woman. Burn into lust one towards another. Men with men, working that which is unseemly, and receiving themselves the recompense of their error, which was the meat. And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them up to a reprobate mind. Who can tell me what reprobate mind means? Sort of. What does the word reprobate mean? Can I tell you, when your mind comes to a final conclusion and you're not willing to think over what you've come to conclusion with. Everybody get that? You're stuck on one thing. One of the greatest things in life is that keep an open mind and let God mold you to what you need. But once you close your mind off, once you close your mind off on God, and all it's going to be is what you think is the ends mean. That's it. You ever talk to an atheist? I've been talking to my fellow worker who's an atheist, right? And we love talking all kinds of stuff. And he finally came to the conclusion that he believes that there is a God. I don't know which one it is, But I believe there's a God that's doing something in this universe that never was like that before for 3.5 years. Oh, all of a sudden now you think there's a power there going to make it. Oh, okay, well, let's just start. We'll talk about which one later. We'll talk about it. We want to do a good study. Go look at Morgan Freeman. Everyone knows who Morgan Freeman is, right? You know, he believes in a God. But you go find out which one. Okay? He's going back to the ancient times. But he doesn't realize it goes even beyond that. Okay? But now you hear all these Hollywood stars, and they're becoming now a spokesman of the Bible now instead of a preacher, a God-fearing Christian, right? One that has total reverence. But be careful with all that. You'll be swayed away. You won't understand what's going on. And it goes in verse 28, and even as they did not like the retained God in their knowledge, they gave him up to a reprobate mind and to do those things which are not convenient, being filled with all unrighteousness, fornication, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, debate, deceit. This is ridiculous. This is the people that sit there and want to sit there and spit the face in a soldier, but most of all spit a face in God. Spit a face in our people that are sacrificing their life on the field for the well-being. You ever see some of the people that sit there have no respect for authority? These are those kind of people right here. Because they have no respect for authority down here, they have no respect for him being the authority. No one's going to tell me what to do. And now they got to live by their natural consequences of their choices on this earth. Be very careful with that. Because sometimes our authorities keep us in a safe place, right? But most of all, some of us even do it in a loving, kind way. That's how God made it. You understand that God loves you, right? You hear more about God, about the love of God, than you do anything else in this Bible. So it all comes back for his love towards you. God is not forbidding you to sit there to be miserable. He's forbidding you to be happy and loved. Because some of our choices, we know, look all through mankind, look all through the history of our Bible. When God was put aside and man chose other than God, it was nothing more but misery and agony, right? But when they chose God, it was blessedness, it was peacefulness, it was joy, and you felt the love of God. Amen? That's how it usually is. So I want you to understand that God, all this stuff's been going to a point where people are without understanding. It talks about in verse 31. We need to realize that God, that's man's position for the decades and centuries. Once man realized that they need to understand and they're willing to go after God, but we got to get to that place. Now, when a person gets saved, amen? When a person receives the Lord Jesus Christ, our whole world opens up, does it not? Our eyes are open. We can see some things now. Our mind is not darkened and blind with understanding. We get to understand now. And lo and behold, listen right here, listen. And once you go ahead and allow God to work in your heart, now you understand what true love is because you understand His love. You understand what true peace is because you understand His peace. When you understand what true joy is because you understand His joy. Hallelujah. And you get to see what a real blessing is. Not manufactured by your hands or by your doings. It comes right down on you. Perfect example, this $2,000 bill, right? Prayers got out, and someone answered their prayer, and $2,000 is now waiting for us to go pay for the transmission. Think about that. Did anybody do hear anything like, do we work and slave at it? No, we just beg God and plead, and God gave it to us. Unmerited. Unmerited. That's God's goodness. That's God's grace. Amen? When a man comes and receives Christ, he's forgiven. When a man comes to Christ, he has eternal life, everlasting life. John 3:16. When a person comes to Christ, we become a new creature. Turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 5. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. I'm winding down here. Look at verse 17, one of my favorite verses. Wherefore, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. That means everything now you're going to experience is new. Old things are passed away. That means the things that you thought were going to bring you joy, the things that you were doing in your life that you thought were okay and brought joy to you, may not be okay. You might have to revisit that, redo that. And then it goes on here, it says, and behold, all things have become new. Like all things are passed away, and all things become new. You get to see things in a different light, amen? You get to experience some new experience that you never thought. You looked everywhere else to gain that peace and to gain that joy and to gain all that strength. And now you're finding strength in Jesus. You're not finding strength in other things. You're finding true love, not in a person, all right? Now you're finding it in God. You're finding true blessing, not by your works, by your efforts to get those blessings. God's, you're doing it, and God's dumping things all over you, and you're like, wow, I got more than I want to handle. God's been blessing me abundantly. Why? Because you became a new creature. Amen? In 1 John chapter 4, we already read this, but I'll read a little bit further. 1 John chapter 4 and verse 9. Should I do 1 John? Let me see. 1 John chapter 4, verse 9. Let's do that, yeah. In this was manifested the love of God towards us, because God sent His only begotten Son into the world that we might live through who? Him. Okay, you can turn if you want. 1 John 4. We get to live through Him. Do you know no longer we have to live relying on ourselves? We can live through Him. So how do you do that? Anything you're going to engage that day, you pray and then walk with God to go through things. When you sit there and you have to do things and you have to go ahead and you sit there, you take this Bible, His love book, right? This is His love book. You sit there and take this Bible that's based on His love and His love book that draws closer to Him. We can start perceiving things. We can start discerning things. And we can make proper decisions because of His love book to keep us in His will, to keep Him in His bosom, to keep Him in His hands. We get to sit there and do things through Him. And then verse 10 says, herein is love, not that we love God, but He loved us and sent His Son to be the propitiation of our sins. Beloved, if God so loved us, we ought also to love one another. There's certain people that are put on this earth just for you. But I don't like him. That person's for you. But I don't want to deal with her. That person's just for you. But I don't know how to handle it. What is that person going to do for me? He's going to teach you patience. He's going to teach you long-suffering. He's going to teach you how to be gracious. He's going to teach you how to love. Because you know what? If God can love the unlovable, guess what God wants you to do? Love the unlovable. But they're a mess. They're in a sinful state of mind. They're a mess. They're oozing with the vileness of sin. Good. Go love them. Right? Can I tell you what I miss? Don't get mad at me. Ready? Can I tell you what I miss? I miss being on the streets, pulling them underneath the bridge out. Pulling them off the street out. Handpicking them from the city mission, coming right out of incarceration. I miss that. Because I want to see what God's going to do on a life. When God gets in, God saves, then God starts restoring. When you see that new creature come up, amen, and you see start God molding a life that you never thought could happen. That's what I like, amen. Lastly, this. Turn to Colossians chapter 1. We'll close with this. Colossians chapter 1. I'll hand over to Brother Rob. Colossians chapter 1. Colossians chapter 1. And verse 19. Colossians chapter 1 and verse 19 says this, for it pleased the Father that in Him should all fullness dwell, right? Does God want, God wants to live in you fully, right? That means all of who you are needs to be given over. And having made peace through the blood of His cross, by Him to reconcile all things unto Himself, by Him, I say, whether they be things in earth or things in heaven. In you that were sometimes alienated and enemies in your mind by wicked works, yet now hath He reconciled. Amen? God's intention is for you to be close to God and to be right with Him. Amen? Yes or no? Will God have more of you? Will you allow God to have more of you this morning? Will you be part of God's process to reach sinners? Listen, we don't need no more couch spectators. Amen? We don't need to be no more cheerleaders on the side. We need to get out there and represent as an ambassador of Christ and witness to the lost souls and tell them how great of a God we have. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Don't look around. Every head bowed, every eye closed. We're going to sing the first and the last verse of Back to Bethel. If God's touched your heart, maybe you need to give yourself more to God. Maybe there's more of you that you need. Let's do it. Let's give it to God. Lord, thank you so much for this time. Lord, I pray that you bless God's people, that you would work in the hearts of each one of us, that we go ahead and allow God to do greater and mighty things in us, but then also be used to be able to reach others with the cause of the gospel. In Jesus' name, amen.